ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जाया मुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपाकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। नमो पंकजनाभाय नमो पंकजमालिने नमो पंकजनेत्राय नमस्ते पंकजांग्रे। ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंध्रस्य ज्ञानांजनाशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। मुखं करोति वाचालां पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुदीनतारिणं परमानंदमाधवं श्रीचैतन्यं ईश्वरं। नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नाम्ने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चातदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्णा चैतन्या प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैता गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंदा। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। सो वेलकम टू दिस सेमिनार ऑन द आर्ट एंड हार्ट ऑफ स्पिरिचुअलिटी। विल बी लर्निंग फ्रॉम अ फ्यू एग्जांपल्स फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम ऑन हाउ वी कैन डेवलप एंड इम्प्रूव आवर रिलेशनशिप विद गॉड कृष्णा। सो फर्स्ट एन इंट्रोडक्शन टू द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ आर्ट and heart of spirituality. There are many spiritual paths, and I and many of my friends, and we all are practicing what is called as bhakti yoga, also known as Krishna consciousness, where we cultivate conscious remembrance of Krishna, the Supreme Lord. And the process is called bhakti yoga. Yoga means to connect or join, and bhakti is one of the ways by which we connect to the Lord. Now, as bhakti yoga practitioners, we also know and we are aware that there are within bhakti yoga two ways of practicing. One is spontaneous bhakti yoga, or where a person naturally feelingly calls out to the Lord as he serves the Lord. So this is a very, very effective practice, bhakti yoga. Now there's another way of bhakti yoga, which is called as a practice, where there are a lot of restrictions, rules, regulations, systems. It's a very scientific process. So the spontaneous bhakti yoga, which very advanced practitioners live by, that is called also as raganuga bhakti, where they just spontaneously love Krishna. The practitioner loves God and he just offers his heart to the Lord and is always remembering the Lord in love. So therefore his spiritual path is a spontaneous expression of love. Whereas for most of us, including me and many of my friends, what we are practicing, although it is bhakti yoga, it is a regulated bhakti yoga, where we cultivate remembrance of God, where we practice remembering the Lord, where we devote certain time of the day to remember the Lord. That is called as conscious or cultivating remembrance of Lord. Srila Prabhupada called it as Krishna consciousness, where we try to purify our consciousness and fill it with Krishna. So, since we are all at the stage of rules and regulations and we practice a regulated bhakti yoga, and this is where most of us are situated in, it augurs well if we understand how we could fine-tune our practices by which we can make bhakti yoga practices very exciting, full of joy and full of happiness, even at a stage when we are kind of focused on discipline, rules and regulations. Although our practices are not spontaneous, we're not spontaneously offering our hearts in love, you know. At the same time, there is a tremendous scope for having a very lively, dynamic, a blossoming relationship with God, by which we experience a great happiness and fulfillment. So how do we do that? That is the subject matter for this seminar. In fact, I hear the lectures and talks of some of ISKCON leaders, and I can see how spontaneous their love and affection for the Lord is. Like when I hear the classes of His Holiness Satchinandan Swami Maharaj, and his genuine appeal for devotees to pray and connect to the Lord. So it just shows how he's performing bhakti so artistically, so beautifully. It's an art. It's a beautiful art. It's an expression. You know, like when I hear Kadam Kanan Swami Maharaj, you know, such devotional, intense kirtans, it just fills my heart with so much joy. Or when I hear animated, lively, expressive eyes, expressions of His Holiness Devamrat Swami Maharaj, his classes. Or when I hear clear, to the point, cutting answers of His Holiness Jayadev Swami Maharaj, you can see each devotee is unique and he's relishing Krishna consciousness so personally. He is practicing spiritual life with so much joy and so much natural spontaneity. Now, this is actually very much desirable, that we have a very spontaneous and natural attraction to the Lord. And therefore, bhakti practices it's actually like an art. If you see, some of the most popular sports are actually artistic. Once upon a time, hockey, India was the greatest hockey team in the world, because hockey was a sport that had a lot of artistic skills involved. Of course, then they made it into AstroTurf and it became very scientific. Even cricket is a very artistic game, because the way the spin bowlers bowl, the way the batsmen would bat. But somewhere, the art was replaced by systems, mechanistic, robotic approaches, very scientific, and the art element is lost. Similarly, for very advanced, beautiful devotees of Krishna, bhakti is more of an art, where they express their hearts spontaneously. But for many of us, it is scientific. We have to practice rules, regulations, we have to be systematic. And generally, when we have rules, regulations, and we're practicing to love God, it's not that we naturally love God, but we are trying to love God, it's very much possible that we get into the mood of office, duty, obligation, getting things done. So it's possible that the practices of bhakti may become a little dry, mechanical, boring, lackadaisical. It's possible. Therefore, we need to have some secrets or some tools by which we can experience great relish, even as externally we are practicing what is called as Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti. Vaidhi means vidhi, rules and regulations. Sadhana means practice. So our practices are based on rules and regulations. So how do we practice to love God? Many people say, love is very spontaneous. You just love God, right? Yes. At the same time, because they're not advanced practitioners, we practice to love God. So therefore, our acharyas, our teachers, Srila Prabhupada and Srila Rupa Goswami, who wrote the Nectar of Devotion, a treatise on Bhakti Yoga, how to practice Bhakti Yoga systematically, has given us a beautiful book called Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, which Srila Prabhupada translated as Nectar of Devotion. And in the Nectar of Devotion, Rupa Goswami has given us 64 items of devotional service. There are 64 ways we can practice Bhakti Yoga, and there are different rules and regulations given. And Srila Prabhupada also emphasizes, Rupa Goswami has also given, that the essence of all these rules and regulations that we have in Bhakti Yoga, the ultimately all the rules and regulations, their essence is Smartavya Satatam Vishnu Vismartavya Na Jatu Chit Sarva Vidhi Nishedasyu Etayo Eva Kinkara. This is the essence of all the rules that we practice in Bhakti Yoga. And what is that? Smartavya Satatam Vishnu. Always remember God. Always remember Krishna. Vismartavya Na Jatu Chit. Never forget Krishna. Sarva Vidhi. All the rules, Nisheda, prohibitions, Etayor, Eva, Kinkara, all rules are servants of these two rules. So the essence of all rules is two rules, which is always remember God, never forget God. So therefore, the whole approach of Bhakti Yoga, the practices that we are trying to inculcate, it is based on this. Remember Krishna. Remember the Lord. So, remembrance of God cannot be scientifically, robotically, mechanistically planned. It can't be like, okay, now I'm going to sit down and I'm going to remember the Lord. 1, 2, 3. Okay, remember. No, it's not going to work like that. So, although we follow rules and regulations, Rupa Goswami has made it very clear, the essence is to always remember the Lord. Yena kena prakarena manah Krishna niveshayat. Somehow or the other, fix your mind on Krishna. So, remembrance of the Lord is basically, it's not a technique, it's a matter of the heart. It's remembrance of the Lord is not an intellectual or a gymnastic. It's not some intellectual gymnastics. It's not some technique. Remembrance of the Lord is more of an expression of a heart that is filled with emotions for Krishna. Therefore, remembrance is an activity of the heart. And, you know, it's like, you know, when a child is you see children, they are small baby, for example, the baby is crying, the baby is feeling helpless. So when the baby calls out for the mother, it's not that the child thinks, okay, now I'm feeling lonely. What am I supposed to do? Okay, there are two rules I have to follow. I have to remember my mother. I have to call out to my mother. Okay, let me follow the first rule. Don't let me cry out for my mother. No, all these things don't happen. It's a spontaneous expression. The child immediately, from the heart, calls out to her mother in a feeling of utter dependence. It's not from a space of analysis or thinking or logic. It's from a space of love. Therefore, ultimately, as we are practicing all these rules and regulations in Bhakti Yoga, we want to reach a stage, or we want to be able to call out to the Lord spontaneously, like a child. Srila Prabhupada writes in many places that when we chant Hare Krishna, we are actually chanting in a mood of a child calling out for the mother, helplessly. So therefore, we are going to discuss now how we can cultivate this mood, how we can develop an ability to spontaneously remember the Lord with affection, as a result of which, if we can do that, then our Bhakti Yoga practices would be lively. they would be filled with a rich experience and will be glad that we are practicing bhakti. So how do we do? So there are two things we need to do to begin with as a bhakti yoga practitioner. Now these two things are based on the principles of yoga. So what do we do in yoga? So those of us who do yoga every day, I'm sure devotees and yoga teachers and yoga students know very well that when you stretch your body, when you do any asana like Surya Namaskar, or when you do your Bhujangasana, any asana you do, you have to do two things. First is you have to stretch yourself, right? Stretching is very important. You can't be just putting your body in a very static position. No, there has to be a little stretch. But you can't keep stretching rigidly and you can't control your breath and, okay, I'm going to stretch myself. No. So comes Theriyamasana. There has to be stretching of the body and also it has to be done in a relaxed manner and you have to breathe. Inhale, exhale. So you'll see that the yoga instructor will tell you as you're stretching your body during any asana that please breathe normally. Whenever you do any asana, they'll always keep reminding you. So they'll come and help you. They'll stretch your back. Okay, you stretch a little. But they'll also keep announcing, please breathe normally. Inhale, exhale, relax. So breathing normally and stretching, both are required while practicing bhakti yoga, sorry, while practicing any yogic asana, right? Like, I remember when I was trying to do yoga a few years ago, I was told by someone that if you do yoga every day, your sleep requirement would reduce and you will be healthy. So we had one yoga teacher and he was teaching around 50 of us. So I was also one of them. And I started really stretching myself. But I realized that I landed up sleeping 8 to 9 to sometimes 10 hours out of 24 hours after I started yoga. And I was wondering what is going wrong. I was really stretching myself. And I explained this to my yoga instructor and he came and told me that you are doing a fundamental mistake. He saw me doing yoga and he said, why do you control your breath? Relax, let go. Inhale, exhale, relax, breathe normally. So that was a revelation to me. I never knew that you have to breathe normally and conscious, relax. So now you can't say, okay, I'm going to breathe. So you can't just sit and say, I'm doing yoga and I'm just breathing. No, you also need to stretch yourself. So there are two elements. You stretch your body as you do the exercise and you also breathe. Similarly, while practicing bhakti yoga, we do two things. Because bhakti yoga is also a yoga, there also we do two things. Like in yoga, we stretch. In bhakti yoga, that stretching of yoga is compared to service. That is why Srila Prabhupada translated bhakti as devotional service. Bhakti is defined as devotional service. Service is like yogic stretching. And just like in yoga, we breathe, we inhale, we exhale. Similarly, in bhakti yoga, that breathing is compared with remembrance of the Lord, offering of our heart to the Lord. So we follow discipline, we follow rules, but the essence is breathe. Means remember the Lord. Krishna, oh God, this is for you. Please accept this offering. Oh Krishna, I'm going for an exam today. Please help me. Krishna, I love you. Krishna, please let me chant attentively. Krishna, my friend is in difficulty. Please help him. Krishna, Krishna. So we are remembering the Lord, which is compared to breathing, as in a yoga exercise. And we just simply don't sit and remember. We also stretch ourselves. We take up challenges. We take up responsibilities. We put ourselves in situations where we will be compelled to remember the Lord. We will be facing challenges. We will be stretching ourselves so that we can remember the Lord with love. Therefore, to practice bhakti yoga, we need to switch on this button, the heart button, where emotions open up. Just like when you switch on the main switch of the house, there may be many switches, many bulbs, but when you switch on the main switch, the whole house is illuminated. Similarly, in our system, in our body, mind, ego make up the whole system, the whole thing that we carry. We have two buttons, the head button or the heart button. So most of us, we often switch on the head button. So head, those who switch on the head button, they're always looking for answers. They're always looking for clarity. They're always analyzing. They're always judging. They're living in fear, insecurity. You know, Srila Prabhupada very beautifully says many times that he quotes the Mahabharata verse, Ahara Nidra Bhaya Maitunam Samanyam Etat Pashubhi Naranam. The common thing between humans and animals is eating, sleeping, sex life, and eating. Defined is the Bhaya principle, Ahara Nidra Bhaya and Maitun. Bhaya means fear or defending principle. So Bhaya is very common. In material world, everybody is living in some fear, insecurity. All our actions are motivated by fear. So just like if you see a hen, the hen is eating some grains from the ground. She's always looking here and there. She's afraid that a cat may come and pounce on her. So that fear principle is very active. When you see a monkey, you know, we see monkeys in Vrindavan. If you're carrying bananas with you, if you have a whole bunch of bananas and you see a monkey, few monkeys come, so you may think, okay, I'll give one banana to each monkey so that they'll be happy. Monkeys are not going to be happy with that one banana. They don't look at that one banana. They look at the whole bunch of bananas that you're carrying. And then they'll snatch all of that. And then if you just stay there and watch them eat that banana, you will see those monkeys, as they're eating that banana, they're not like they're peaceful, they're happy, and they're like, oh, relishing the taste of the banana. Oh, this is the taste of Krishna. No. They're eating with a lot of anxiety because another monkey will come and snatch and fight. So this insecurity is not just amongst monkeys. Monkeys represent, you know, we can learn a lot from monkeys. Human behavior resembles to a great extent. So we also have a lot of fear and insecurity. It may not be grossly manifesting like in eating of a banana, but many of our activities, the way we work, the way we possess money, the way we save, we hold, our relationships, insecurity, fear, that is what is driving us. And when we are driven by these insecurities and fears, our head button is always on because we want to save ourselves from predators, from animals, from hunters. So we are, our sympathetic nervous system is hyperactive. We just don't know how to relax. We are always in the move. We're always running. So therefore, our whole bhakti practices. So now we come to bhakti yoga. We come with this head button on. And we have not learned to switch on the heart button. Somewhere we haven't made this important transition. Therefore, despite the external practices of bhakti yoga, we may realize that we're not making tangible advancement. Well, just like a yoga practitioner has to breathe normally and relax, similarly, a bhakti yogi has to switch on the heart button. He has to remember the Lord with affection. He has to experience a dynamic, active relationship with the Lord. Unless that happens, his yoga is incomplete. There's only one element in that yoga. Service is there. Along with service, there has to be conscious offering. It is a choice. Remembrance of the Lord, switching on the heart button is a choice. Otherwise, we will be simply doing activities. We will be doing services, but it won't constitute bhakti because bhakti is service plus offering of our emotions to Krishna. Devotional service. It's not simply service. Practice bhakti yoga. But for many of us, God, religion becomes, he says, Krishna consciousness becomes a neck above religion. He says we should understand that bhakti or Krishna consciousness is a neck below religion. And he was explaining it. He was saying that neck above religion means the head is here. So we think that bhakti means I have to analyze all this. I keep figuring out all the answers to all the problems. I need to have all the solutions. I need to have a lot of clarity. I need to have acronyms. I need to have solutions. I need to have 3 formulas, 4 points, 5 points, you know, 3 ways to improve chanting, A, or, you know, all that. Four reasons why this happens, 5 points. So that's all a neck above religion. That's all the head, a hyperactive head. You are saying we need to understand that bhakti is a neck below religion because the heart is below the neck. This is the seat of emotions. This is where relationships blossom. This is where we find purpose, where we find meaning in our relationship with the Lord. So therefore, we need to bathe our heart. We need to water the seed of bhakti, which is there in the heart. So this is the question. How can we make bhakti yoga a heartfelt process? How can we experience rich emotions for Krishna? So there are a few things we need to do. Now that so far we have discussed two important points. First, so far we have discussed that we need to do two things to make bhakti a heartfelt process. First is we need to render service, and second we need to remember the Lord. To experience the real benefits of bhakti yoga, we need to remember the Lord and we also need to render service. Now we are discussing on how we can remember the Lord. What is the way we can improve the quality of our remembrance of the Lord? So for that, the Srimad Bhagavatam reveals Shrinvatam sa kata Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana Hridayantasto Yabadhani Vidunoti Suhutsatam. The process begins with Shrinvatam, hearing about the Lord. This is the first step. Hearing from the proper source is the first step of remembering the Lord. And once we start hearing, then the different rules that we are practicing, different rituals that we do, those rituals will get internalized because we are hearing about the Lord. So, you know, like in the 7th chapter of Gita, the Bhagavad Gita, first 6 chapters speak mainly of Karma Yoga. 7 to 12 is mainly Bhakti Yoga, and 13 to 18 is Jnana Yoga section. In the 7 to 12 Bhakti Yoga section, the very first verse of the 7th chapter, Krishna says, Shunu, touch, Shunu, Arjuna, hear, listen. So Bhakti Yoga begins with hearing, listening, attentive. So now some people you may see, they may not be sitting and reading Bhagavatam, but they are seekers, they are spiritualists. They may be following the principle of listening by their lifestyle, by their practices. They have a habit or they have a culture of being present, listening, receiving. All this is part of the culture of Shravan. Like when you read the Journey Home, which is a memoir, an autobiography of Vidurinath Radhana Swami, he writes how as a young seeker, Richard, he left home, Chicago, went in search of God, went to Europe, then came to India, hitchhiking from Europe. And all his trials and adventures, you will see many places, you would spend time, you would spend hours sitting on the bank of the river or on a mountaintop, just meditating, just being present and listening, receiving divine guidance from the Lord, from the universe. So that process is called the listening. And you'll see, eventually, at Rupa Goswami Samadhi, if you read Journey Home, you read how Eventually, Rupa Goswami Samadhi, he had a spiritual experience and he actually internalized the process and he accepted Krishna consciousness as his own. And then he surrendered to Krishna. He joined the Krishna consciousness movement and he became a disciple of Srila Prabhupada. Journey Home reveals the journey of a seeker to God, who was very attentive, always in a mood of receiving, listening, he was present. So similarly, we are practicing Bhakti Yoga. We are also constantly attentive, at the right, like for example, a class is going on, very attentive. What is the speaker saying? When we are chanting, we are listening. Just being present and listening, divine wisdom is revealed. Now, many times, those switch on the head button. If right now you have switched on the head button, then you will be analyzing whatever I am saying. But if you have switched on the heart button, you will be simply present. You will be simply present. In fact, those who listen, sometimes we think, you know, to understand, I have to think. No. If you simply listen, you understand. You don't have to analyze. You have to just be present. You know, it's not that you have to always be thinking. There is a space beyond the mind where we are simply present. And we allow the divine words, we allow the wisdom to enter our heart, purify and reveal to us. That's why Zolina Pradhan Swami Maharaj, while sitting on the bank of Ganga at Rishikesh, he could hear the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra chanted by Mother Ganga herself. That was possible for a seeker to hear, to receive. So the universe, you know, there's a conspiracy. Krishna wants us to come back to him. God wants us to love him. God wants us to revive our relationship with him. So he has arranged the whole universe to tell us, to give us lessons, to give us messages, to reveal to us. We need to keep our receptors on. We need to tune in our antenna. We need to be receiving. So of course, we may not be able to receive and hear Hare Krishna Mantra like Isurana Pradhana Swami Maharaj, but I'm sure we can. If we are sincere, when we are hearing a class, we are present. Or when we are chanting, when we are listening to the holy name, that process of hearing, that process of shun, that process of being present will awaken love. So I was talking about hearing as a first step. So you will see that those who hear attentively, they actually develop love for Krishna. Abhadrani, the Bhagavatam says that all the inauspicious things go away from the heart and the dormant love awakens. And you will see that many people who have this culture of being present, attentive, listening, and when they hear transcendental sound vibrations of Bhagavatam, they develop natural attraction to Krishna. So when they come and practice Bhakti Yoga, it's like they come with heaps and heaps of spiritual credits and they're already in love with the Lord. For them, Bhakti vows that they take is just like, it's like somebody, you know, somebody already loves a person and then gets married. It's like love marriage. Like Radhana Swami Maharaj joining ISKCON and, you know, taking initiation. It's all like love marriage. You already was following the food regulator principles. You already heard the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and you was already associating with devotees and he was already in Vrindavan, and then when he actually took vows to serve Krishna, it was like a marriage, but that marriage was preceded by a love. So that was like a love marriage. But our relationship with Krishna, most of us, it is like an arranged marriage, where we are, we have no idea who Krishna is, just like my grandmother tells me this story. This is in no way, I'm in no way endorsing child marriage. But I remember growing up, I would be very fascinated. I grew up in a village with my grandparents. So my grandmother would always tell me the story of her marriage. When she was 8 or 9 years old, she was married to my grandfather. This is the year 1927 or something like that, mid-1920s. So she would tell me her story with great relish. She says that when she was getting married, her parents, her cousins, her sisters, everyone tell her, you're getting married. And she says, I was also excited because I knew that marriage means I'm going to get a new dress. I'm going to get a lot of attention. And there's going to be a big party, big festival, big puja and all of that. So she was excited. Although she had no idea who her husband is going to be. She had no idea what it means to get married to someone. So many of us, you know, we got initiation. Many of us came to Krishna consciousness. We had no idea who Krishna was, but we were so attracted by the so many other aspects of the relationship with Krishna, the beautiful, gorgeous temple, the wonderful association, the succulent prasadam, and the gorgeous outfits of the deities, the festivals, Rath Yatra, wow, beautiful. So it's like a young girl, like my grandmother in this story, we're excited about marriage. We're excited about a relationship with Krishna, although we don't know who Krishna is. It's like an arranged marriage. My grandmother would tell me that she had no attraction to my grandfather. She had no idea who he is. And after marriage, she was staying with her parents and he was staying with his parents. But regularly they would come, they would visit her house. So when my grandfather would come with his family, my grandmother as a young girl would be told to take, you know, milk or sweets and etc. and serve my grandfather, that is her husband, who was a little older than her. So she would say, no, I don't want to serve him. You know, I don't like him. And there were others would say, no, he's your husband. You have to stay with him the whole life. No, now go and serve him. Give him this. So then she would go very reluctantly. She would give him milk. And then from her sisters, elders in the family, she would keep hearing, you know, he's your husband. You should talk to him. He's such a nice man. He's managing this. He's a, like this. He's like. So she would hear glories of her husband whom she has married. And should also be trained to serve him. So eventually, at a certain age, then she was told, she was sent to her husband's place. She started living with my grandfather. That was many years, almost 10 years after marriage. And then, you know, they had children, and then they spent so many years. They spent almost 60 years, 65 years together. And they definitely had love and deep bonding. But how did that bonding develop? How did that love develop? It developed by two things. There was service, and there was constantly hearing and association of those. People were telling her about a relationship with her husband. Therefore, for many of us, for whom our relationship with Krishna is more like an arranged marriage. Now, it's not like Bhakti Tirtha Swami or Radhana Swami or many, you know, I've heard the story of Kadam Kanan Maharaj. They were all like, they were in love with Krishna when they came to Krishna's Khan. They were such a spiritual seekers, and they were really, you know, into it. But for many of us, it's like, you know, we have been preached to and we accepted with faith what our elders told us, what our seniors told us. And years later, we are wondering, oh, why my relationship is not working with Krishna, what is going wrong? But that's when we need to understand, we need to work on two principles, constantly hearing about Krishna and serving, Shravan and Seva. Of course, there are some unfortunate people for whom relationship with Krishna is neither like a love marriage nor is it an arranged marriage. For some unfortunate souls, it could be forced marriage. You know, there are some Arab sheikhs who come to these remote slums in Hyderabad or some place. And they would pick up some 8 or 9 year old poor girls from extremely economically deprived families, pay them some money, pick up some girls and get married. And these girls have no idea what's happened. They are actually literally forced to marry. So they hate their husband. They hate everything from day one. So sometimes, you know, somebody may be forced to become a devotee, a gun on your head. You chant Hare Krishna. You know, a parent may force a child to chant Hare Krishna. So some of us may have a forced marriage with Krishna, a relationship that won't sustain. Some of us may have a love marriage with Krishna. Some of us, for most of us, it's arranged marriage. We heard with faith from senior devotees about Krishna, and we committed ourselves. We started chanting, and then we are with Krishna, and we realize, oh, I've spent so many years. I'm initiated. I'm chanting. But what is my relationship with Krishna? Am I experiencing an active relationship? Is there dynamic emotional churning in my heart? Do I feel for Krishna? Do I offer my emotions to Krishna? So for that, we need to do two things. Hear constantly about Krishna, as the Bhagavatam recommends. And then we also render service. Now, I would like to read a section from the Srimad Bhagavatam, the first canto, the fourth chapter. And then we will take this further. And we will take up two examples from Srimad Bhagavatam eventually. And we will discuss how we can make this beautiful process of Bhakti Yoga a heartfelt process. And we can develop a dynamic relationship with the Lord. This is the fourth chapter of the first canto, which is called The Appearance of Sri Narada. And we find an interesting section. The sages at Naimisharanya, they're asking a series of questions to Suta Goswami. And Suta Goswami has answered those questions. And then the sages want to know more. they asked Sutta Goswami that, can you please tell us how Srimad Bhagavatam was actually spoken? Can you please tell us about the speaker of Srimad Bhagavatam, Sukadeva Goswami? Can you also please tell us about the hearer, Parikshit Maharaj? Can you tell us something about him? So they're asking these questions and they're very excited to hear. And while glorifying Sutta Goswami and telling him that we want to hear from, please tell us, one of the verses they chant, which is a very important thing which we'll take up today, and we'll continue this verse again tomorrow if needed. And then we'll also take examples from the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam to corroborate this. But this is a classic verse, 1st canto, 4th chapter, text number 13, where Shaunakadi Rishis are asking Sutta Goswami that, please tell us about Sukadeva Goswami, please tell us about Parikshit, please tell us about Srimad Bhagavatam. And you can tell us, because you are relishing Bhakti Yoga. You are an amazing devotee of Krishna. So while glorifying Sutta Goswami, this is a verse they chant. I'll just repeat this verse. Tat sarvam na samachakshva prishto yadya kinchana manne tvam vishaye vacham snatam anyatra chandasat. We know that you are an expert in the meaning of all subjects except some portions of the Vedas, and thus you can clearly explain the answers to all the questions we have just put to you. So this is the last verse which the sages speak. And then Sutta Goswami is going to answer, and he's going to speak the next 15 chapters glorifying Sukadeva Goswami, Parikshit Maharaj, and how Srimad Bhagavatam was originally presented. But interesting to note, the last question or the last comment by Shaunakadi Rishis is, you can explain the answers to all the questions because you are expert in the meaning of all subjects except some portions of the Vedas. So I remember the first time I read this, I thought, are the sages saying that Sutta Goswami is not an expert in some portions of the Vedas? Oh, does that mean Sutta Goswami is not as qualified because he doesn't know some portions of the Vedas? Oh, that means he is not the best? Is that what it means? No. Srila Prabhupada clarifies. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur explains. All our great acharyas have explained that this is a very beautiful way of glorifying Sutta Goswami, saying that, you know, you are relishing bhakti so much. You are with Krishna. And you may not be an expert on some sections where a lot of pronunciation, you know, some of the Vedic mantras are practiced with a lot of proper accent and meter, they have to be chanted. So Sutta Goswami was not into ritualistic chanting of the mantras. He was more into relishing bhakti, more into remembering the Lord with great devotion. So the sages are very clearly establishing right in the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam that you are too good. You are the best because you are relishing Krishna. And you may not be an expert in chanting of some mantras, and you may not be a great technically sound mantra chanter, but you understand, you know Krishna. Therefore, you are the best qualified to answer our questions. So please tell us. Please answer these questions. So Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport that there are two kinds of people. One is the Brahmanas who perform sacrifices, who chant mantras. And then there are Parivrajak Acharyas. There are learned preachers. They give transcendental knowledge to everyone. So both Brahmanas and Parivrajak Acharyas, both are important. The Brahmanas may chant mantra, they may maintain traditions. But Parivrajak Acharyas, the learned preachers, they go around, they teach everyone, and they may not be expert in chanting mantras, but they understand the meaning, they understand the essence, and they make the subject matter relevant for the audience. So therefore, there is no difference between these two. In fact, the preachers or the devotees who relish and who understand and make Krishna consciousness relevant, they may have a lot of realizations because they are dealing with the world, they are helping people. Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport a very beautiful sentence. realization is more important than parrot-like chanting. I'll repeat. Realization is more important than parrot-like chanting. Many times, we are bhakti yoga practitioners. We start memorizing Bhagavatam verses, we start chanting verses, we get distracted by the externals. But Srila Prabhupada clarifies, it is the realization. And you'll see in ISKCON, in Krishna consciousness, this realization is given a lot of importance. You will see in ISKCON especially, there's a lot of bhakti, there's a lot of bhava. And anywhere you go to any place for holy, like even in Udupi where I am right now, I see that many people, they have a lot of appreciation for ISKCON. They say ISKCON devotees, wherever they go to temples, they take darshan, they are like full of life. There's a lot of bhava, there's a lot of feeling, there's a lot of devotion. And they may not be like the traditional Hindu brahmanas who chant mantras very rigidly, but who lack that life of devotion. You know, when Srila Prabhupada had come with his foreign disciples and they were touring India, one man challenged Srila Prabhupada. He said, your American disciples, you know, their pronunciation is not proper. They are chanting these Vedic mantras, but they don't know how to pronounce. Swamiji, this is not correct. So Srila Prabhupada told that man, their pronunciation may not be right, but their renunciation is perfect. So more important than pronunciation is their devotion, their renunciation. They actually love Krishna. See that. So often, you know, we get impressed by somebody chanting mantras in Vedic sacrifices. You know, there are a lot of mudras and yajnas, and you know, like when we do yajnas, we chant mantras and we make all those mudras and different signs to the body, and also certain mantras we chant in certain meter. And like people who hear it, they think, wow, this is really, really impressive. And we get distracted by the externals. Therefore, bhakti yoga, the essence of bhakti yoga, if we want to switch on the heart button, remember, we are talking today about, now we have always switched on the head button. Head button is when you are like impressed. It's all external, razzle dazzle, glamour. But the heart button is the feeling. It's where emotions develop, where the heart starts growing with emotions for Krishna. The heart button is switched on when we rise beyond rituals, where we become somebody like Shuta Goswami. He's being recognized by the Shaunakadi Rishis at the place of Naimisharanya that you are the perfect person to speak on Srimad Bhagavatam, because maybe some portions of the Vedas you may not be chanting perfectly, but you are relishing all the subjects. You have Krishna with you. So if we want to relish Krishna, we have to switch on the heart button, where realization is more important than simply the externals. Therefore, you know, but externals are generally very impressive. Like if I chant mantras, you know, Om, Raham, Rihim, Ruhum, Ram, Ram, Rom, Saha, Mitra, Ravi, Surya, Bhanu, Kaga, Pushan, Marichi, Aditya, Hiranyagarbha, Savitru, Arka, Bhaskarebhyo, Namo, Namaha, Swaha. Wow, that's awesome, Prabhuji, that's awesome. Oh, what mantra chanting, how beautiful. You know, we get impressed when somebody chants mantras in a grand way and there is fire sacrifice, and we can easily get distracted. Therefore, as bhakti yoga practitioners, the main lesson, the main message that we have to take home from Srimad Bhagavatam is that the essence of offering the heart to the Lord is more important than the external rituals of any spiritual practice. Now, that doesn't mean rituals are not important. Rituals are important, but they have to be practiced with active remembrance of the Lord. Now, there are two things. One is blindly rejecting rituals, and the second is blindly following only rituals. So now, having understood, this is what we discussed today, is the introduction to this seminar on art and heart of spirituality or bhakti yoga. So now we'll take a case study from the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Before we go into the case study, I want to summarize the introduction so that we know where we are. We are discussing on how bhakti yoga essentially is one of the ways of spiritual life. And in bhakti yoga, there is a spontaneous practice which the pure devotees practice, and there is a regulated bhakti yoga, which most of us are practicing, where we follow rules and regulations. And the essence of all rules and regulations is to remember Krishna, to remember the Lord with love. And remembrance of the Lord is not some mechanical activity where we switch on a process and start remembering the Lord. No, that is a way of consciously offering our heart to Krishna. And for that, we discussed today how we need to do two practices. One is hear about the Lord regularly. And we'll take the case study now to understand who is the best example of somebody who is hearing about the Lord. And secondly, cultivating a service attitude. When we do these two things, the heart button gets switched on. And although we have had an arranged marriage, quote unquote, arranged marriage rather than a love marriage with Krishna, that relationship with Krishna will blossom into love when we inculcate these two practices of hearing about the Lord and also rendering active service. And then we took this verse from the first canto, fourth chapter, text number 13, where we learned how one may not be an expert in chanting of mantras. One may not be expert in external activities of bhakti. One may not be an expert. But if somebody has the right attitude of hearing and rendering service, he will experience deep, fulfilling emotional satisfaction in Krishna consciousness. And for that, we have a beautiful example in the 10th canto, which we will now take. This is the example of the wives of Brahmanas. They were Yagic Brahmanas. They were performing sacrifices. And they were learned scholars, but their wives were not great scholars. Their wives are simple women. And in this pastime, Krishna proves how if somebody has a simple heart, if somebody has an attitude of service and sincerely hearing about the Lord with an open mind, one can develop deep relationship with the Lord, far, far more effective than simply dry performance of rituals. Now, again, I want to clarify, we are not saying rituals are not important. In fact, rituals are important. In fact, so many things happen because rituals create a good space. Like, for example, when you come in front of the Lord and you fold your palms like this, and there is incense and there is a temple atmosphere and you stand and then you offer prayers. All these are rituals, or all these are processes and systems that help us enter that space where we can pray to the Lord. Now, we don't need all this, but this helps. Now, you can't just say, okay, I have the Lord deity form, and I'm going to have a laid back attitude. I'm going to spread my legs, and I'm going to sit like this, and I'm going to offer my heart in prayer. No, that won't work. Because to offer a heartfelt prayer, we also need a certain space. We also need a certain kind of setup. So that's that ritual, that system helps. And every process, every activity has its own set of rituals. So rituals are important. Like when you meet another person, you have a ritual. You shake hands, right? Why do you shake hands? You shake hands because you are touching, you know, you are touching a person, you're showing affection. How are you? Good morning. This is a ritual. Although this is a ritual, this may not be the main essence of a business dealing, but the ritual helps enter the space of trust, helps enter the space of camaraderie, helps enter the space of affection. Similarly, we have certain rituals in bhakti yoga, like we put on tilak, we put on dhoti, we stand in a certain posture, we greet each other by saying Hare Krishna. All these rituals help. So we are not discounting the importance of rituals, but we are simply saying that rituals help us connect to Krishna. They help, but they are not everything. They are not the all and all. They are simply a tool. They simply take us closer to the Lord. But offering of the heart, that is our choice. And that is exclusively our prerogative and individual devotee's prerogative. So we will take example from Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto of the Yagic Brahman Patnis in tomorrow's class. And while studying the example of these ladies, we will also discuss how we can systematically offer emotions to Krishna and how we can make the right choices and what are the different ways we could begin to improve our loving offering to Krishna. That we will discuss tomorrow's class with the example of the Brahman patnis. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Grantra Srimad Bhagavata Mahapuran ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shri Shri Radha Gopinath Bhakta Samaj ki jai. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.